First, I'm going to introduce the candidates. This is Eric Ekstrand. This is Dave Zick, Scott Thorson, Doug Edge, and Dave Andren. I'm going to let them introduce themselves, give you a little bit about themselves, and then you can ask questions. Go ahead, Eric. This is what you get for being last in the room.
Hello, I appreciate everybody coming out tonight, taking part, and then learning a little bit about those of us who are looking to get your vote November 6th. Thank you to Mary for pulling this together in Atrium for allowing us to have it here. So my name is Eric Ekstrand. I've been a resident for about, 15, 16 years. I got a little flyer over there. It tells a little bit more about me than I can do here. Married, four boys, all very active in football, which is why there's no one else here except my mom, because they're going from football to religion at St. Peter's. So my wife teaches there. I've been involved in the community in various aspects with volunteering at Cowern, which three of my boys all went through, and one is still there, to being part of the North St. Paul Athletic Association, volunteering coach with football and baseball, and obviously part of St. Peter's. So I've been involved in city politics, just more from an exterior perspective. I did sit on a committee for PolarNet and kind of acted as an advisory role. My background is in IT. I've been working for a company, United Health, for about 15, 16 years, about the same amount of time I've lived in North St. Paul. I manage a team there of IT professionals, and so that's one of the reasons I got involved in the PolarNet, is because I was one of a few that actually had an IT background and could speak a little bit intelligently about what was trying to be done there. So that's a little bit about me. What I'm looking to do in City Council is, I see it as a civic duty. I see it as your responsibility as being part of the community. If you feel like you can be part of that community and maybe provide some benefit, I think you should step up. I think that gives a little background on why I've done a lot of the volunteering I had. And we had the candidate meet and greet a few weeks ago, I think it was, and I made the statement, I'm one of those people that it's hard to, keep your hand down when people are asking for volunteers, which is one of the reasons you get sucked into, repaving Cowern's play lot and, doing some of the work that we did with the PTA years ago when my now 17-year-old son was going there. So that's a little bit about me. Hopefully you guys have got some great questions for us. I'm looking forward to them, and look for your support November 6th. Thank you.
Thanks, sir. Next is Dave Zick.
Dave Zick, excuse me. I think most of you have met in town quite a bit. I've been a resident of North St. Paul, 65 plus years. My wife and I have lived here in our current address for 45 years. Graduate of North, long, long time ago, I don't want to give the date, but I did start in the same building and graduate from the same building. Did serve in the United States military, retired from that, and I had the privilege of serving in the North St. Paul Fire Department for 33 years here. The last 13, I was the chief. Since I've left that, I volunteered, and I still am the emergency management coordinator for the city. My wife is director of the food shelf. I got stuck as president of the board because I missed the one meeting when they were going to do it. It's a lot of volunteer time, but it's a great community. It really is. I serve on the Police Civil Service Commission, and I did also serve on the City Council for 6 years. Kind of hard want to get back at it and live. If I can be of help, that's what I want to do. I understand kind of how it works because I did serve there and I did work for the city. Or people say I'm an insider. Well, I guess I am kind of, because I know how it does operate and I know the people that are doing it. So, coming up on November, if you don't think I am too old and if you think I can do a good job, I would appreciate your vote. Thank you.
Scott Thorson.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming out. My name is Scott Thorson. A little bit about myself. Born and raised in North St. Paul. I went to elementary school at L.C. Webster, middle school at John Glenn. I graduated from North High in 2002, and I too started and ended at the same school, but that was a new school. I went to college at University of Wisconsin-Stout for 2.5 years, studied in general business administration, and I changed my major to accounting transferred to River Falls. Got my degree there. I've been working at a local accounting firm in town, Thorson, Breyinger, and Novak. Also, when I moved back into town, I joined the fire department. I've been on there for almost 6 years now. And I think I can bring a business background perspective, just kind of a different, younger viewpoint to some of the council decisions that have been made, and look for your support in November.
Doug Edge.
Hi, I'm Doug Edge. I've been in the city now about 18 years, and before that I was in the Navy, U.S. Navy, for back in 89 to 92. I was over in the Persian Gulf, worked on an aircraft carrier. I was a firefighter in the flight deck. And I believe strongly in our Constitution. That's why I went in. I'm a patriot. I really believe in America, but I think a lot of the reasons I'm running is the breakdown in our country. You can see in our national debt, all these types of things, but it starts here. It starts at this local level. You can see it. The 18 years I've been here, I've seen the breakdown in this city. I apologize to residents. I really haven't been out a lot to talk to you yet. I've been really focusing on businesses and talking to them, getting an idea of what's going on. And I mean, they're the backbone of what makes a city strong. That's where your image, everything comes from, is your downtown area, your businesses. And they're also the charitable. They give to the, you know, you have the Legion, you have the VFW, and all the other ones. They give to the sports, the associations, to the food shelves, all that. And when I see the city, you know, treating their ordinances like a tax because they've broken down, and you know, we get state aid here, and they're looking for other ways to get money, and they start abusing the ordinances. You know, it's time to step in and ask some questions. I know we had an issue last year. I don't want to get into that right now, but it really made me see how the leadership in this city treats you. And I hope to God nobody here has to go through what we went through. But the deception and things that went on were ridiculous. And I can talk to that later on. But it's so sad because when I was a child, I lived in apartments over by the ball fields. And we were only there for maybe a year. But I loved going to the park, Silver Lake. I just love this town. For some reason, it's stuck in my mind. Beautiful parks, all that. The downtown, I love the car show. There's so much diversity down there that I don't think the people in the rest of the area really know. And you know, again, I started seeing that breakdown. We really got to support these businesses and the people. And when a bad name gets out there and you treat people bad like that, the word gets out. These businesses have other you know, clients and people they talk to. The word gets out. And when you have a bad image, you're not going to bring business in. And eventually, when that breaks down, they're going to come after you, the citizens. They're going to raise your taxes. When they run out of places and to squeeze money out of, they're coming after you. And I know we have elderly here. You're in fixed incomes. You can't afford it. Between that, the state, the federal government, enough is enough. So my whole platform is your voice. If you have an issue, whether I agree or not, I'm going to stand up for you. I'm going to go in there and ask questions. I notice a lot of the council, you watch these meetings, and they just nod their heads and go along with the mayor. Well, I'm not here to be on the mayor's side. I'm not on anybody's side but yours. Now, does it mean I agree with you? Not necessarily. I'm going to listen to you, get the facts straight, and then I'm going to take it to the meetings. I'm going to take it to whoever I have to get the word out. Nobody is going to be able to treat it the way me and my wife were treated in the last year. There's an issue going on right now. I've been singled out. And they forced me to take a sign down, one of my signs. I called the state, got some questions from them. It may be wrong where it's at, but I went around, I have pictures, I can show you all the other signs in similar places, yet they singled me out. They refused to even deal with it. And the only one that contacted me is Candy Peterson. If you look around this room, you were at the last meeting, guess who showed up? Candy Peterson. When I have an issue, guess who showed up and contacted me? Candy. She is the only one in this city that will contact you and work with you. Again, I may not agree with council. If I get on there, and I'll put my personal opinion aside and work hard and be professional. But I will ask questions. I will get to the bottom of things. I love this city. It's a beautiful town. And hopefully you can make a better place. And if I don't get on, I want to work with these gentlemen and get more involved. And I expect if I do get on, it's up to the citizens, really. You got to take charge. You got to, you know, a lot of times we all wait till something happens and then we look for something. But you got to get involved. You got to ask questions. And that's what I'm all about. I'm here for you. I'm here to be your voice. Thank you.
Dave Andren.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dave Andren. I've been a citizen here for 6 years. I've been working with the school district for just about 10 years. I've got a great passion for the city. I'm back in the 80s when, which is now the Gateway Trail, I'm the one that pulled the track out of here back in 1980. So, and before that, when I was a young boy, some of you who are a few years older, I probably remember when we used to have the dump over here by Oakdale. I lived on the outskirts of that when I was a young boy. So my roots have always been in North St. Paul. When it was a chance for my wife and I to move back here, that's what we did. Since I've been back here, I've been on the Parks Commission. I'm now Vice Chair of the Parks. Just to give you a little background, some of you know me as, you know, the person out there that's, I do volunteer, I help bring concerts in the park, those kind of things. But in 2 years ago, I ran for one of these seats, and I did meet a lot of you. Went door to door, just about blew my kneecap out, but I wanted to meet as many people as I could. This year, I'm focusing a little bit more on the businesses, because as I was out campaigning, I've got different rumors that, you know, there's some bad blood between the city and some of our businesses, and a lot of our businesses, not so much. They're happy with the way things are going, but there are other businesses that don't feel that way. And it was kind of surprised that there's some of the businesses that have been here 35 years and said, you're the first candidate or anyone from the city who's even come to say, how's it going? What's an issue? I met with some of the neighbors here, some of the residents, 2 years ago. When they had a question, I may not have had the answer at that point, but I did take down their information. And I would drive back to their house, the ones who didn't either give me a phone number or something, but I would write down their address. I stopped at their house, they lived at whatever street, and I would go to the city and say, what was this issue? What is, this person needs to have some understanding. Then I would drive back and give that to them, just to give you a little history on that. But what I'm all about is trying to build a better communications with the city, our businesses, and our residents. We need to have a better understanding of our local government. We're just kind of willy-nilly going with stuff. A good example is we just had a couple of issues in front of the city council. A couple weeks ago, they changed their ordinance to a certain point. Last night, again, they were trying to rechange the ordinance. This is not the way we want to run our city. This is not the way I see the city should be run. I don't think you need to see it run that way. We want to have policies that are set black and white and say, this is the policy. The citizens here agree on it. We need to start helping our businesses grow a little bit. They're the ones that need to expand. We should be trying to help them rather than hindering them and making some kind of enforcement saying, no, we don't want that. Well, why don't we want that? We want to start growing the city to make it more user-friendly to all communities. A good touch is, for instance, our car show brings in a lot of people on a Friday night. I've seen both sides of that happening. It brings a lot of great business. We have one businessman I talk to. Every Friday night, he banks that money from the car shows to help him get through those troubled times. This is good business move. This is things we need to help have happen. We need to have more of our community activities out there. A good example is when we had the parade. I grew up in St. Paul Park, a small little town. And those little communities, when you think about when your childhood, you think about all those good things. And the parade that we had just recently for 125 years, when I saw that parade, it brought me back to my childhood memories. We need to have those kind of community services here for our citizens. So when we take our kids there they go, I remember that. When they're my age, they'll look back and say, do you remember that down at the Splash? You ever go to the Splash? You had a good time there, didn't you? It was great. We need to do that. We need to start building that, those bonds again between the residents, our local government, and our businesses. Without this kind of growth and this understanding, so we're all on the same page, we're just going to keep following the same path all the time. We have one or two people say, well, this is the way I think I want to have it done. And everybody goes, yeah, okay, nobody wants to set up and say, but Mrs. Smith over on 7th Avenue has an issue because the sidewalk's broken. Now you want to do this, and this is how you want to charge her. This is not what we need to do. We need to be more out there. We want, as a city entity, we need to be looking at every one of our citizens. We need to be finding ways for different businesses to want to come in. We need to be following some volunteerism. I'm a strong believer in that. Otherwise, they wouldn't be on the Parks Commission. We have to help, like I said, our small businesses have ways to help them get established. Find different modes, maybe a tax break for a couple years until they get established. Once they're established, they're part of this town. Then the owners usually move into our town. It's great for all of us. It's a great sense of community. But this is what I'm all about. And this is, I'm going to be your voice. Just like some of the others have said up here tonight, I will be your voice. So when you have that problem, a concern, you call me up. Area code 651-774-8889. That's my home number. My email address is dandren36@gmail.com. I'm just putting it out there. So if you have a question or a concern, and if even if I don't get elected, I will, if you have a concern, I have no problem trying to find out what it is that's a problem. Like I said, we need to have a government now that's going to, when they make a policy, we're going to stick to that policy. But make sure it's every all the I's are dotted, all the T's are crossed, so there's none of this back and forth and all of a sudden somebody's losing revenue or those kind of things. So we need to make sure that we're all in this together. Together, you and I can make this happen. We can form a better government, not just the willy-nilly way we've gone in the past. Thank you.
Thanks, Dave. Well, here's where I was going to open it up to questions, and we had two questions put into the box, so we'll ask those first, and if we have time, then we'll ask more. The first question is, what is the future, or what do you see as the future of the Anchor Block site? Are you aware of the site? Do you know what you see for the future of it? I'm not sure if you guys have answers to those questions, only because you're not on the city council yet.
Where do you want to start?
Start right with you, Luke.
We'll go reverse next time.
Okay, we'll go reverse next time.
Actually, I talked a little bit to Nate last night before the city council meeting, and obviously those of us, you know, we're aware of it. We know that there's a lot of empty lots in North St. Paul.
Okay, I asked him, you back here.
Oh.
Is that working?
Yeah.
All right.
We'll have speakers down there.
I'm kind of disappointed in myself. Usually I don't need this. So let me repeat what I said. So the question was about, do we know what's the future of Anchor Block? I actually spoke to Nate a little bit last night prior to the city council meeting. There's no current development known for that site. There's no nobody looking at it. Nobody's aware of anything that's going to go in there. The city has obviously they are working with Anchor Block. Anchor Block has paid off that site, so they're not in really big hurry to turn it over. It's about, I think, $3 million they're looking for that site. If, is that
okay. About $14 million.
$14 million. Okay, so so quite a bit more than what I was informed of. So I think the challenge with that site and other sites is obviously transportation to that area. There's the concrete area right there. I can't remember the name of the group that's right there. So you have a question on what kind of facilities could go in there. Is it going to be residential? Is it going to be commercial? You know, could there be office buildings? But right now, there's no one looking at that site. So I think we're seeing what we're seeing across most of North St. Paul, where we have a lot of open space, but not a lot of interest in it. Main reason I've heard is because we just don't get a lot of traffic in that downtown area. I think I heard we get 7,000 vehicles down 7th per day and most companies looking to develop are wanting considerably more traffic than that. So, you know, what we would look at for anchor block is, again, to continue to try to, you know, from my position, if in the city council, you know, we have this EDA, you know, really understand what they're doing there to try to promote the city, how they're going about it, and what can be done, and what kind of businesses are possibly looking at it. But I think we're in a bad position in that we have an economy that's in rough shape. We have businesses that are hesitant to expand. And then we have a location in Anchor Block that is not all that accessible and is not maybe all that desirable because of its location to other areas and other businesses that are there. So,
since we're on this, the second question that was put in the box was what are your ideas for attracting new business? So Eric, you might as well just...
All right, so the ideas of attracting new business, you know, I have some definite questions related to how the EDA, the Economic Development Administration, is functioning. I think in last night's city council, it was apparent to most people that what they're trying to do is make the EDA relevant, and it's really not. This was related to the gas station that's near the church in downtown, across from the VFW. They're looking at paving that over and making it a parking lot so that Reflux Medical can expand into the parking lot next to the church and allow more parking on the other side of the church where the gas station currently is. And the city is going to work a deal, not to get into the particulars of it, to purchase that site, but transfer it to the EDA so the EDA looks like it's actually doing something in order for the state to continue to give the EDA grant money for us to try to develop North St. Paul. And for me, it looks like a shell game, to be honest. It's trying to make this organization in a town of 11,000 people be relevant, and it really isn't. And I mean, that's one area that I guess I would try to understand more is, what is the function of the EDA? Why is it there? And is that really a full-time position for a city like ours? And how much are we paying for that position and to do the work that's being done there? So that's, from my perspective in a city council and in a role as a city council member, working in business, there's a quality initiative, and one of the things that it says is you should always ask why 5 times. I don't even hear why being asked once. Because in this philosophy, by the 5th why, you get the answer on what truly is the reason that something is happening or why something is occurring or why we're doing something. And last night, when this was being discussed, there was very few whys being asked from the council, from the city. And it was very disappointing for me as a city council or as a citizen, because I'm looking at it from the same perspective you are and saying, just doesn't, you know, I'm a kind of guy, if it doesn't smell right, look right, or taste right, probably isn't right. And we need to do something about that. So what to kind of close it down and give others a chance to answer, we need to seriously look at what the EDA is truly doing. How are they promoting the city? How are we talking to other businesses, not only in the city, but also other businesses? Are we networking with these other organizations? Are we finding out what about our city is not positive, or what is keeping businesses away from us? I know there's been a lot of talk that the bars are a big reason, and which I know a lot of people have been concerned that, you know, maybe that's why this whole Sunday ordinance thing has come about. But the thing is, we can't be in a position as a city to turn businesses away that are in North St. Paul. We should be working with these businesses. If there's an issue there, we need to work with them to fix it. And if they can't fix it, well, then it's kind of on them. But we should not be in a proactive state trying to close businesses down. Right now, it's those businesses that are keeping North St. Paul viable. And if we completely shut those businesses out, what businesses are going to want to come in knowing that the city council actively tried to close a business down? So we can't be in that mode. So I think it's about education. It's about understanding what are we doing, what are other cities doing that are our size, that are in a similar position. Last night, again, we heard on the city council meeting, you know, there's a lot of comparison to us with Oakdale and White Bear Lake and Maplewood. Well, mean, it's not an apples to apples comparison. We should be looking at cities within our state that are in a similar size, that have similar scenarios, and what are they doing to deal with the economic issues and the development issues that they have. We should not be trying to do this in a bubble, and we definitely should not be comparing ourselves to White Bear Lake. I'm sorry, much different demographic there, much different population, much different, you know, just completely different in my mind. It's an apples to oranges comparison, and that does nobody any good. And that's this whole discussion about assessments. They're comparing us to Maplewood and White Bear Lake. It's just not in my mind, a logical way to approach it. So I hope I answered those questions, and I'll let the other gentleman answer them.
Thank you. Sir.
Well, Anchor Block, Eric did cover quite a bit of it. It's not a real good location for people to come in, access off of 36 or off of McKnight. But Anchor Block site does have some drawbacks. You've got the Gateway Trail going through it. So whatever's going to happen there is going to have to be planned out. Undoubtedly, it would be a mixed occupancy type for business or residential. The remark was made about we don't have the traffic to support downtown or support there. Until we get more residential in this area and in downtown, we're not going to have the traffic where your restaurants or your small stores are going to come in or other businesses. The city itself is out actively trying to draw these businesses in. They come in, they take a foot count or a traffic count, it's just not there yet. Until this traffic count gets up with the redevelopment that we do have to do, we're not going to have these businesses. I've heard it a lot, the city owns a lot of property. Yeah, we do own property. And I say we because we are the city, not just that building over there, it's all of us. We do own property. But this way, they can market the property, which our EDA is actively doing all the time. The EDA was formed when I did sit on the council. We're getting the grants because of the EDA, otherwise it wouldn't be eligible. When you have to clean up a site, this city could never afford to clean up the site like they did for Reflex Medical. Have to clean the site up where Right Price Gas was. If you've noticed the pipes in the ground down there, those are recovery wells. The gas tanks were leaking. We could never afford to clean that up. We need the state grants and the county grants to help us clean it up so we can develop the property. Look up at where the old school bus garage was. It's a massive cleanup up there. We've already gotten one or two grants. This has brought in new utilities up there and everything to make that site more pleasable or more attractive to businesses that may want to come in. There are several businesses now looking at it. That's not a bad location. They're working on getting the proper infrastructure in up there. One thing you do want to remember, if any businesses come in here, the city's going to have to help them and work it with the TIP. We're going to have to do a lot of infrastructure work in the city. Everybody knows that. We're an old city. Our infrastructure is bad. We're going to have to bond. I know that word is bad because that's money. But because of the work the people have done over the past 10 or 12 years in actively going out and doing this, the city holds a fantastic bond rating. That may not seem important, but it is. It's very important. If we have to borrow money to go in and put infrastructure in, because of the work that's been done in the past, we're going to get a great rate on it. This is going to make it easier for us and make it more acceptable to a business that would want to come in here. So I guess Anchor's got its problems because of Shipsky there. Shipsky's been a long-time resident. They've been a good neighbor in this city. They've paid a lot of taxes. They use a lot of utilities down there. And that's great. That all helps. But in the master plan as it's being developed, I'm sure you'll see the day Shipsky's will be gone too. This is going to be all a mixed area of probably apartments maybe on the south end, businesses, or office complexes. I know in the master plan that's what they want. That's a ways out, but we have to work toward it. So really, until we get more traffic in this town, we're not going to have a lot of business opportunities. They've tried three or four restaurants. They've taken the head count. When they come out, these businesses come out and count the traffic. If it's not there, they're not going to do it. But the city is actively promoting, trying to get these in, and the EDA is very active. They also have business retention. These people go out and talk to the businesses. They do try to help. I mean, everything isn't perfect, believe me. I'm the first one to admit it. But most of the work being done is moving toward getting the redevelopment in here for businesses and for our neighborhoods. Thank you.
Okay, so the original question was, what was the end?
Anchor block. What do you see
okay. Well, Anchor Block obviously is privately owned by the Anchor Block Company. So it's kind of a private thing where they're going to sell it to whoever's interested. The city should actively help promote that. But I guess my biggest nightmare would be that the city would purchase that lot, because then they have the ultimate say over who they're going to sell it to. In this economy, it's kind of hard to cherry pick what you want to see in there. I mean, I'm sure there's a laundry list of things the city would like to see in there, but in reality, it's probably not going to happen. So I would certainly hope that they would never prevent something from moving in there, like a Walmart. I know that's a controversial thing. But if Walmart wants to move in there and Anchor Block is willing to sell it, who are we to stand in their way? If they're going to succeed, it's because people are going to go there and shop there. If they aren't, then they're obviously not going to succeed. As far as this traffic issue goes, in a couple of years, we're going to have a new Stillwater Bridge. There's going to be a lot more traffic on 36 here. That's an interchange at McKnight. There was a lot of controversy over the Margaret Street Bridge, and that Holiday gas station was going to go out of business because of that. Well, I work right across the street, and oftentimes I'll walk over to get coffee, and I'm standing there waiting because there's plenty of traffic. I don't think they're in any danger of going out of the business. So I mean, you hear these things, and you know, they're kind of knee-jerk reactions. The city's role should be in a supportive role. It shouldn't be to take total control. The comprehensive plan, that's kind of a guideline. It's a wish list. They're not going to see everything happen on the comprehensive plan. Working with businesses is a big thing that I think the city can do a better job of. One personal example I can use is my father's accounting firm. They received no help from the city. They didn't get any tax breaks or anything. They private, and I think they wanted it that way, because when you get the city involved, then they put these speculations on things. But they still had to adhere to that. They had a plan to purchase that building, which a lot of people, if you remember, was kind of a eyesore. Okay, it's a commercial office building. They submitted the plans, and it went through the committees and got spit back, where they wanted it to be a two-story building with residential apartment up top. No more pull-up parking off the street like you see over at Bigley. And then they had to have a certain amount of green space. And it almost got to the point where they were going to say, well, I guess we're going to look elsewhere. Fortunately, cooler heads prevailed, and they allowed them to build what they have there. But, you know, to me, that's just unacceptable. I mean, we should be working with existing businesses. That's the goal of the EDA. We're in a instant gratification type society. I think the EDA is only 2 years old. There is a lot of potential in town for growth. So their job, in Paul Amerman, I believe is his name, is the new EDA director. His full-time job is to promote North St. Paul. And I think we need to give him time to do that. And in this economy, we're not going to see something pop up right away. Restaurants was mentioned. If I want to open up a Culver's, I believe as a franchisee, they have speculations on where to go, but if I wanted to put a Culver's up where the old Tap and Grill was, I'm well within my right to do that. It's a commitment from the business owner to say, hey, you know, I'm gonna do this, the city's working with me. You know, they like to throw these traffic counts out and say, well, it's not gonna happen. Well, I think there's more to it than that. So the role should be to work with business. Business Association, that's their goal. The EDA, that's their goal. And I think that should be the city's goal as well. They should be helping rather than a hindrance. And I'll leave it at that.
Thanks.
Well.
Do you want to hear questions again, just in case?
No, I'm good.
Okay.
Well, first of all, it seems to me if you have a house and you want to sell it, it's not selling on the market, what do? You clean it up. You paint it, clean up the yard, get rid of the fat. We got to clean the city up. It's time to change the leadership. Wally Weispel's had 15 years here, and what has he done? He's making a fortune. He makes a lot of money. Not only that, then he gets an assistant. He's paying that. We got a lot of overhead here. First, we cut that. That sends a message out to businesses that, hey, there's some change going on for the positive. You got to keep tax rates low. You know, part of the council and a city's job is government doesn't create jobs. They create an environment for jobs to come here. When I bought my home, why did I buy it there? I looked around. There's some beautiful areas around Minnesota. It's a nice place. That's why we're here. But I looked at the value of my house and the yard I got compared to Woodbury and Oakdale and then my taxes. They were great. Now, I don't know. The taxes went up. I look at some other areas, you know. So people look at them when they come in. So do businesses. They look at infrastructure. I worked with City of Maplewood. I've been in public works for 18 years, and I worked for years before that in road construction and that. The city, they're going to come in, businesses come in, and say, are there major capital improvements that need to be done here? Am I coming in at a time where next year, 2 years down the road, I'm going to get nailed for this? So that's why you keep your infrastructure up. You know, a big question I have here, a little off the subject, but we built this beautiful public works building. We don't even have a public works crew to run it. Why did we spend all that money for that? I don't understand it. You have Shifsky's out, great company, but why are they out patching my streets? These were decisions made by Wally Weispel and the rest. Highway 36, again, I talked about an environment for business. Where are the ramps at on it? Do you think, how do you think Woodbury would be without Valley Creek Road, without, you know, Lake going in there and some of these other ones? Business would drive right by. Well, that's what they're doing here. Like Scott said, we got a new bridge going in. There's going to be a lot of traffic. How are they going to get here? People, let's face it, they're lazy. They're not going to want to go through McKnight, whatever. We took that away. So your city hurt your business by not fighting to get that in there. Not to mention, don't forget, we have police and fire right there. If there's an accident down on 36, they got to go all the way around. Century's been backed up now for how long? How are they going to get there? They failed. Where was the responsibility of your, you know, Wally and all of them to make sure that we got some ramps there, you know, for access, mutual aid to other cities, all that. So cities, governments love to talk about safety, but it's usually when they want to raise your taxes on something, so they want something else. They don't care about you. Same with seatbelt laws, all that. It's just to get money out of you. That's all it is.
So how are you going to change that for us, Doug?
Change leadership. Start there. Paint the house. That sends a message out. And as far as those properties go, at the last meeting, it was kind of interesting. We were at the Legion, and one of the old-timers came up to me and talked to me. He said, you know what I think the city needs? He said, we need, you know, apartment complex and all that. I said, well, I think we have some senior housing. He said, no, not senior housing, young people. He's absolutely right. That property would be wonderful. Some sort of apartment building, try to get some young people in, and I think part of that is you can sell this car show to them. You can sell the Gateway Trail to them. Highlight the great things about this town. You're close to the lake. They can take their children there. And let's face it, when they're younger, a department, hey, start out there. Get to know the city, enjoy it, and then buy a house here. Move your way up and stay here. Maybe even start a business here. That's what you got to do. You got to change the leadership. Like I said, he's at 15 years, and where are we going with this? What's your value? What are you getting out of your people there? It's time to cut the fat and send a message to business. They'll get it out to their clients and other people of what's going on. Hey, there's some good changes in North St. Paul. The other thing you do is you come out and you talk to businesses like Atrium. I'll admit, I'm not exactly sure what you guys do here. But what you do is go around to the business, and I don't mean spend 25 grand to have some company do it. I mean, walk door to door and say, what would you like to see in this town? What businesses would help your business? And then we go directly market to them. And that's what you need to do. Find out what the businesses here want. I mean, there's your resource right there. But again, go door to door. The people that live here, you don't need to spend 25 grand like governments like to do. Do it on your own. It takes a little bit of work. And I guess that's my main thing. We just change some leadership.
Dave, you're up.
Boy, you know, this is rough being last. But to answer the question with Anchor Black, yes, that is a privately owned lot. But as far as the city part is concerned, if the lot needs to be subdivided to say maybe have two or three businesses come in there, being it's in that type of zoning, that's what the city should be looking at. Not to say, no, it can only be one thing and one thing only, which we've done in the past and driven out some of our businesses. We need to start looking at those kind of things. Like most of the gentlemen up here have already spoken. We need to talk to our local businesses to say, what do you need to see come in here? And in the city, to answer the second question, we need to be promoting the things that are great in this city. Our, for instance, like you said, the car show, that's a great draw to the city. We need to be promoting that. The fact that we have great parks, so people say, look, this is a great place to come to. It's worth coming off Highway 36 and driving 2.5 blocks to come downtown, and not just downtown, we have great businesses throughout the city. I've talked to quite a few of them. But there is a reason to come 2 blocks off that highway to come and see North St. Paul. People drive out of their way to some of the smaller towns because they have great businesses, some things that are drawing them there. We can't be compared to like we were just the other day, because we were talking about some street assessments, the city is, and they were starting to compare us to Hopkins and a few of the others, just like Eric had said, with Hopkins. And I said, yeah. Hopkins of all places. Well, we're not Hopkins, I'm sorry. Maybe someday we can get that name where they say North St. Paul and everybody gets in their car and heads here. I want to see that. But we need to stop and be realistic about how we're looking at when we're taxing our people and taxing our businesses. We can't be comparing to White Bear. We can't be comparing who are bigger than us and they have room to expand. Where we're stuck, we're in, we can't grow any more land here. So we have to promote what we have. You and I together can help do this. We can tell our friends or neighbors that we got a great restaurant, if we can get one, but we need those. We lost a tap, that was a pretty big draw. Traffic wasn't an issue, really it wasn't. Because if it's worth driving there, your people are gonna come. I go to different areas because there's certain things that draw me there, just like you do. We want those businesses. We don't really want to start going, keep going to the mall all the time. What are we going to do? We're going to go to the mall. What's great there? I mean, yeah, some of the stores are next to it, but we want some of that atmosphere. We do have that in this town. We need to start promoting it more. So to draw more businesses, we have to promote the fact that we have great parks in this area. We have a great downtown. We have great community leadership. If we can get that, hopefully we will in November, that are supporting each other. The citizens and the residents are supporting the businesses, the businesses are supporting us, and when I stop and I listen to some of the businesses here, their tax base is off the chart. I mean, a couple of small businesses are paying over $30,000 a year in taxes here. It's just astronomical. I pay almost $3,000 for my lot here. I know there's some that pay a lot less. I love this town. When I first bought this, the bubble popped. I saw my property value drop, my taxes went up. But do I say no? I love this town. There's no way I'm ever gonna move out of here. I'm gonna be here for the rest of my days, just like most of you people out there are gonna be. But we have to start promoting what we have and build on that. With just saying, well, we hope we get something in here. Geez, I hope something else gets in here. With that kind of stuff, we're just gonna stay stagnant. We need new leadership. That's why all of us are up here. We need to start having your voice heard. We need to have the business's voice heard so we can start meshing this together. So with me being your voice and you calling me with your concerns, I'll make sure that those get done. So that's pretty much all I have to say.
Well, we have no more questions in the box, but oh, we have hands shooting up.
Let them come up.
Drew?
Yes, I read a while back in a paper, the mayor team said that we're a manager-run city. So we've got three people have a stranglehold on everything that happens. How can you change that?
Are you directing that to just
anybody? I just want to know an answer to it.
Well, the city manager is hired by the city council. And if the city council all falls into the same line, not holding our city manager to what we seem, where we want to see the city. His job is to be working for us. We tell him this is where our citizens and our businesses want to go. Your job is to bring us there, not the other way around. It seems like from what I've seen, is our city manager at this point is saying, this is where we want to go. Example, last night at the city council, when he ran out of questions, he said, Wally, what should we do? And I'm thinking, oh my God, it should be the other way around. Wally should be saying, council, what do you want to do? We need to turn this around. I think we get the right two people in the next election in those seats, get some fresh young blood in there, and could be, you know, maybe older age, but young blood, a new set of eyes.
We can change, turn this around.
Yeah. Either our city manager will say, yes, I have to conform to the way that the policies are, which is set by the city council and the mayor, and take control of our city again, or he says, you know, this job isn't worth it, and moves on somewhere else. Maybe the White Bear or Hopkins, I don't know.
We can only hope.
But your vote in November is going to change all that. Either you want to go back to the same good old boy group, or you want fresh young blood. Or old blood, but new.
Well, I think it's a great question. It goes back to my whole leadership thing. First of all, the mayor, you know, I don't even know where to start with that. I don't think he realizes what his role is. Wally Weisbull runs the day-to-day operations, but the mayor is supposed to take charge of the city. He is not supposed to jump whenever Weisbull calls or the chief calls. Do your job. Your job is to take care of the citizens of this town. And that means if they have a question, they have an issue, you talk to them. I have an issue going on right now. He's yet to answer it. Candy Peterson, the only one that answered it. That's it. None of them. So again, change of leadership. Now, I think the mayor is still in for 2 years, so I can't do nothing about that, but I can tell you this, he will not go unopposed, whether I'm in or not. And whether that means I back someone like Andy Peterson or somebody else, I will fight and do anything I can to get him thrown out of office. This guy has no clue what he's doing, and the worst thing is, he's on the Met Council. Are you kidding me? That just shows you why this state is so screwed up. I mean, this guy has no clue. And there's so many things I could get into. I can maybe talk to you after this thing about it, but you know, I do want to bring one. I was attacked. Me and my wife went to talk to Wally about an issue we had going on. And do you know that Wally Weisbull didn't want to talk to me? But then he came around, this was after a council meeting, he comes around the table, and if I'm the mayor, he's the mayor, he came over the top of him and tried to hit me, grab me, I don't know what he was doing. Wally Weisbull was screaming at the top of his lungs and trying to hit me. Do you know the mayor sat there and did nothing? Do you know Jan did nothing? She was standing right there.
I'm trying to keep this positive, but I'm a little passionate about this. Negative road, I don't want to touch on.
Well, politics happen to be negative. I hate to say it, but that's one side of it.
They do, but the question was about the manager.
Well, and that's just it. The manager runs this town. And you're absolutely right. Change of leadership. And later on, a change of in the mayor. But between now and then, you need a council that'll stand up to him. Luckily, last night, some people asked some questions and stood up to him. It's a start. Is that because the election's coming up? I don't know, but it's a start. So there's some hope there. But I can tell you, if I get on, he will not go unopposed, or he will be getting questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
We're all going to get a chance to answer the same question. I'll be brief. Yeah, the city manager's role is to manage the city, but he gets his direction from the elected, the mayor and the council. I think that might be one problem that the city's had for years and years, is the council and the mayor haven't been as engaged as maybe they should be. They rely heavily on his opinions and what he says to go, and they roll with it. So I would like to take a more active role in the decision-making processes. You can't step in and tell him, hey, you got to hire this guy and pay him this. That's not our role. That's his role as a city manager. But he gets his direction from the council. So I think that answers your question.
Thank you.
Anybody else want to take that one, or should we start with
as far as I'm concerned,
Eric? Yeah, I have something to say. You're absolutely right. You know, I heard that comment too. It's a city manager-run city. I went to the website and I read how the city is organized, and it's contrary to that statement. And I think if you watch any of the city council meetings, most of what the mayor says is contrary to what reality is. And nobody calls him on it. Absolutely right. The city council drives policy, which is then implemented by the city manager. There is way too much of these city council meetings where they're constantly looking to the city manager to answer all of the questions. And that just can't continue. It just can't. The only way that that's going to change is we need to implement an organizational rule around how the city council meetings are run. That is the only way things are going to get addressed appropriately. The city council, I talked to one of the city council members and I said, what rules govern the city council? We don't know. It just kind of has always been that way. Okay? I have a background in Robert's Rules of Order. I'm sitting in city council meetings and I'm screaming, call the question, which means vote. Shut up and vote. Okay? Because there's this constant back and forth that's happening and it's going on and it's a complete waste of time. They're calling motions, they're having motions, it's being seconded, they're having endless discussion, and nothing's getting discussed. And then the vote, they completely forget what the motion is. And then they try to change the motion. Now, I'm not an expert in Robert's Rules of Order, but I know enough to know there's nothing governing the council. And if you look at my website, because I'm a tech nerd, I have a website, I put on there, one of the things that I'm planning on initiating, if and when I get elected, is I'm going to say we need to institute rules around how the city council meetings are run and clearly understand what the hierarchy is and responsibility. And that clearly is the mayor, the council, city manager, and then everyone else underneath. It should not be the other way around, which is the way it is being run today. And it should not be that way. That basically, and this is the meeting two weeks ago, there was a motion on the floor. There was a motion related to the liquor license. Wally interjected. Wally is not an elected official. He is not an elected member of the city council. He should have kept his mouth shut, to be frank, unless he was directly asked a question by the mayor or the members of the city council. During a motion, non-elected officials have no say unless they are asked by the council to interject or clarify something. That should never have happened, and that right there is a clear indicator of who's in charge. The council should not be going into these, and I know we have previous members of the council and Candy's back there, and you know what? What's being done today needs to change, and that's one of the things that I would want to do is come in and say, listen, we need to agree not only on what our city charter is. What is the city's purpose in life? What is the city council's purpose in life? Does anybody know? What is the city council's job? Has anybody defined a charter, you know, for the city? No, for the city council. What is its directive? What is its role? Then what are the rules that govern it? Why do we go to city council meetings, get 10 minutes to talk publicly, and then listen to everything that they're going to do to us and not have any ability to say a word? I made the mistake of thinking I might have the ability to do a point of order or a point of information because I just had a question. And I got gaveled down, Mike sent me to my chair, and that was it. And I talked to a city council member and I said, how about we move that portion of not even a major change, let's move that section to the end so that we hear what is being discussed, what is being proposed, and then now we have a chance to actually respond to it instead of having to wait 2, 3, 4 weeks to come back and try to say something about it. Because this is the issue that I have with the city council chambers. The reason these are public meetings is they're meant to be open to the public, not just for you guys to sit there and listen to us talk or listen to them talk. It's meant to get your input. It's supposed to be a public forum, which is why it's open to the public. But yet the way it's been organized and the way it's been run, it stops public input. Because it says you've got 2 minutes to speak or 3 minutes to speak, and if I don't like what you're saying, I'm shutting you down. I mean, they shut that lawyer down a few weeks ago. He's a lawyer. Somebody's paying this guy ungodly amounts of money and they shut him down. I mean, come on, out of common courtesy, I would have let them talk 5 minutes.
Yeah.
All right? But they didn't. And that needs to change. A lot of statements about good old boys network. Yeah, it is. That is politics. Unfortunately, it's, you know, there's a lot of that, you know, it's not what you know, it's who you know. But the thing is we've got to make a change. And if you guys are frustrated with the way things are run, you've got a number of folks up here that are saying, we want to go in and make a change. And so I hope, you know, out of the two seats that are open, I hope I get your vote. Because I think I can make that change. I think I've proven that in my public involvement in the past. Hopefully, me explaining my position on some of these things related to the city manager explains I have a little idea of how things I think should be organized and run. So, thanks.
Thank you. Just to clarify quickly before we answer this question, I know Eric had mentioned he's not sure if there is any Robert's Rule of Order. There is actually. It's in the city codes. I think it's section 4. And that is the guidance that the city council meetings are run on top of the Robert's Rule of Order. Now, obviously, it strays from that from time to time. And there is an official flow chart of the organization of the city. Citizens are at the top.
Yep.
Mayor, council, city manager, on down. And that's all available on the website, but it's very hard to find unless you've been there before. And maybe that's another thing we can improve on, communication is making things like that one click away rather than 8 or 9 clicks away.
And it may be
just
there,
to clarify.
Yeah, but it's not being followed, and that's the problem. The Robert's Rules of Order is not being used in any shape.
Well, I just wanted to, I mean, you pose a question like it was there, yeah. Nothing on there, but it is in there.
Obviously, we've got some really passionate people, and they're all getting into it, but we have some more questions. Yes,
absolutely.
Guys. Go ahead.
Use your microphone?
Yep, go ahead.
We'll just make this so everybody can hear my question. I'm Kevin Rogers, and I've lived in North St. Paul for my whole entire life. Born 1954, went to North High and all that good stuff. This is my personal question to me, because I've never been explained, never been told, say North St. Paul, that I've been aware of, and never made a point to explain who owns, who gets the power for our mystery wind generator. I mean, to me, I may be totally out to lunch on this. I'll just pick a number on this guy. Maybe as residents, we should get 1% off of our bill because we have a wind generator. I don't know that. Maybe that's unrealistic, but I'm just throwing it out there. I'm not done.
That's not related.
We started at the end. Can we start in the middle?
Yeah. It's a three-part question, real quick.
I don't think that these guys can answer that fully because
okay.
They're not,
that's not why we're here.
On the council
well,
right now.
Well, it's something that whoever gets elected needs to deal with, so I'm bringing it to their attention so that they can be aware
sure.
of it's my concern.
Well, let's let him finish his
You know, we've yep. got summer rates for our electric bill
yep.
that go up higher. Why is that? I don't know. It shouldn't be that way, I don't think. Also, I heard a long time ago
that Sir, that's not why we're here tonight.
I'll finish my question, then I'll get down, and then Paul, you can have your turn, perhaps. Ben, I've heard that electric is going to, we're paying maybe a company out of Canada we get electricity from. Years ago, we used to generate our own electricity, long time ago. Who's going to be our supplier of electricity? At what rates? When is that going to come into effect? So there's a lot of questions, and maybe they don't know. But these are questions that our candidates should become aware of. That's my question. Thank
oh,
you.
Absolutely. They should be aware of. But I'm just saying that there's a good possibility that they can't fully answer that kind of a question.
Yeah, just real brief. I know that the city of North St. Paul's gets their, like, they're in a co-op, the MMPA. Beyond that, your answer of the questions like cost or whatever, it's a mystery to me. But I'll finish up quick. As far as that windmill, you know, in my opinion, it's just kind of a symbolic thing to prove that there's a mandate by 2025, the state of Minnesota has to have 25% of their energy renewable. Yeah. Is that realistic? I don't know. Is that thing, they claim it at peak capacity, it can power 110 homes. Is that true? Where do we get those answers?
Across the street.
Across the street. And I agree, you know, there are a lot of times people ask questions and they don't get answers. If you ask me a question, I'll tell you, I don't know, but I'll find out. If you ask them a question, I think it's kind of, well, let's just ignore them and they'll go away. So it's a communication thing that at least I'm looking to improve on. If someone asks a question like that, there's obviously someone who does know the answer and as an elected official, it's our responsibility to find answers.
Absolutely.
Right into it. I did some checking up on the electric utility.
Okay.
All right. First question was, why are the summer rates different than the winter rates? That's because of the demand put on the whole grid system across the country. Every electric utility is tied in to the national grid. When the demand goes up, they have to bring more generators on plant online. This is what costs us more. Your rates in North St. Paul right now are about 3% lower than XL. We haven't had a rate increase in this city since 2010, and there is none planned for 2013. So it'll be status quo on what you pay per kilowatt hour. Right now we're paying 9.88 cents per kilowatt hour, October through May. That's your low demand time. June through September, it's 11.02 cents per kilowatt hour, plus a monthly demand charge of $6.88 a month. That's because of the increased load. And as Scott said, the reason we get electricity out of Canada, some comes out of Texas, it comes from all over. The people at MMPA, the company that runs the 11 cities, they're out there constantly. Electricity is a traded commodity. And they're all the time trying to find the lowest rates they can to get it in here. And what Scott said was absolutely true on the turbine. It's symbolic. There's no way this nation's going to have electricity from solar cells and wind turbines to supply our needs. What a lot of people don't know, every turbine that's in hooked into the grid, ours isn't in the grid, ours is in local. So that power's coming right to us and not going out. They have to have backup in case the wind's not blowing or the sun's not shining. And green energy's great, but it's not the best. People say XL's base rate is a little lower than ours. Granted, their base rate is a little lower, but they have 12 riders. Different fees they charge for every bit of electricity. Like I said, our demand is 688 on high demand, and XL is 708. The businesses have to pay a demand rate, you know, industry and businesses and that. North St. Paul is 1010, XL is 1048. So we are about that 3% lower. And along with around electric, but one more quick thing, a lot of you probably saw all the yellow tags on the poles. Bad poles, they're in the process of replacing them. City is 75% done, our electric utility is 75% done replacing these poles. And now, that utility is managed very, very well. Some of the other cities within our consortium hired an outfit to go out and check the poles to see which ones had to be replaced. One of our sister cities that is an MMPA spent over $250,000 just to get the poles checked. North St. Paul did all of this in-house.
Come on, Dave, we're not here to talk about telephone poles.
Uh-huh. We're here to talk about electricity, sir, and I just answered it. I'm just saying we've got a well-run utility. So that's all I want to know. I hope that helped answer what you wanted.
Doug has something to say.
I asked that same question to Wally Weisbold a few weeks back at the last meeting before it. It was to meet the manager and go over some things. I asked him about it. Just like Scott said, his answer to me was, Doug, it's symbolic. It virtually does nothing. And then about the mandate, he said, we need a 25% mandate. That's why they got the grant money to build it. I said, so wait, it says 25%? He says, no, doesn't do anything. He said, that mandate is throughout all the other groups in it. So they all save about 1% or less to get the 25%. So my question to him was, then why do we need the grant money to build something that doesn't work? Again, this goes back to government, and it's just ridiculous. That's why we're $17 trillion or more in debt. Enough symbolism.
Sir?
Two things. One, you guys saying why we can't do stuff because we're comparing ourselves to White Bear and other cities. Just for your information, the fastest growing small town on the east side of the river is Hugo, which is 8 miles north of White Bear. So maybe someone should do some comparisons as to what have little towns like North St. Paul done to grow and become more self-sufficient. My second question, and this is to the four of you, not Scott, because I know he knows the answer. Do any of you know what top-down budgeting is, different than bottom-up budgeting?
Is that like what the military does?
Yeah, everybody does one of them too.
Yeah.
And it's amazing I didn't see you on the Nimitz. You know, there's only 6,500
people.
Oh, I was
on the Nimitz.
Really? Amazing.
But
yeah, everybody does one of them too.
Right.
But does anybody know? I've been in the private sector. You know, I own my own business for 40 years, so I know what I did to survive. It's simply one of them says, "This is how much money I got. Then I'm going to determine how much I'm going to spend." The government in this city is no different. Says, this is everything I want, and this is how much I'm going to tax the hell out of everybody so we can get it. Like bicycle racks. You know, we need bicycle racks in this town like we need a hole in our head. This is all feel-good stuff. It's like that big white thing that half the time don't go down. Makes certain people feel good. But in my own household, and you guys all have your own households, you spend what you got. But see, government thinks, and there's people that are sitting up there who have never had a real job, as I call it, okay? You have an unlimited checkbook. And that's taxation. And that's exactly why this country's in the trouble that it's in.
Thanks, Al.
So, let me comment. I'll do a quick comment. I have a real job.
But that's my question. I do. And I understand you have a real job. But you know what the difference then is in your company. Mm-hmm. I know she does because it's in the paper all the time about what's going on with this company.
Thanks a lot.
And then walk through there and you're going to see a lot of empty desks. That's top-down budget.
Well, it is 7 o'clock.
I'm talking about the fact. All right, I'll come back at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. They're still going to be empty.
Okay.
This company's in trouble, all right? Yeah. And that's why top-down budgeting is saying, until we get our revenue stream back up, we got to cut costs. Very simple. And I don't know, you know, being a computer weenie, I don't know if you know about any of that stuff or not. You know, because they're kind of in the middle.
I don't know if I should be offended. Or
well, you said your own website,
No, that's great. So let me give you a little bit. I'm not an accountant. Nor do I play one on TV, so I'll defer all my accounting questions to Scott. My wife does our taxes, I will fully admit that. However, in my role at United Health Group, I do manage a team. I'm responsible for hiring and firing, which is not fun. We are in a position right now where I have to make hard choices around funding, and I have to make hard choices around who's gonna stay, who needs to go, and it sucks. Hate it. I'm a nice guy. I don't like firing people. But I also understand that the company I work for doesn't have an unlimited funding source and that they're preparing for whatever this election is going to do, right? So from a budgetary perspective, my role, I'm an engineer. I manage engineers. And we work with teams that have budgets. And they have to work within that budget. And we have to make sure that we're building things that are in that budget. So. As a computer weenie, I have to make sure that.
So if you weren't running for politics, the quick answer would have been yes, you know.
Yes.
And then you've been done already.
Yeah. But working for a large organization, I got to deal with politics. I mean, I work with, I mentioned this in the other, and then I'll sit down because I don't want to be too long-winded, but I work with different business units, I work with different individuals, I work with tech weenies, and I work with business meetings. And so I have to work with a bunch of different people, and I really do equate the role that I play similar to what the city council has to do. They have to work within a budget, they have to work with staff members, they have to work with the police department and other members of the city. They also have to work with the other members of the council, and they gotta work together in the end. But does that mean you roll over? No. You still gotta fight for what is the right thing to do. And you know, top-down budgeting, absolutely. We've got to start living within our means. Now, to the city's credit, they are working on that. LGA, local government aid, is diminishing, and they're trying to handle that. As part of handling that, though, it's increasing taxes, increasing fees. Although our electric rates aren't going up, our water rates are, the assessment rates will be. So we are going to see an increase. We aren't seeing an electric. I think they said that's the one thing we're not going to see an increase in. But everything else we will. Garbage, water, sewer, the tax assessment process will change. That was discussed in the workshop this past, yesterday. So we are going to see a tax increase. Although electric has been good, we're not going to see it. We're not going to see that maintained everywhere.
Hey, Zach.
Just keep going down.
Does anybody else have comments?
No, that's good.
Yeah. Okay. I think just real quickly, what Al's question was basically, you know, what kind of perspective between, you know, normally governments, here's our wants, versus a normal person, you know, it's a, you know, what's a want versus a need, and there's a different spectrum when you're personal, individual life towards the government, and, you know, I think we have to ask the same questions, and I don't know if those questions are being answered or have been. With as far as budget goes, they're raising property taxes, the levy set at 2%, I hope it, everyone that's concerned is going to go to the Truth in Taxation hearing and have questions. My question would be, when property taxes go up, the council votes to approve it, they get one projection from the city manager. Do they also get another version of that projection when property taxes don't go up and show areas where cuts are made? Then do they get a third projection where property taxes actually go down and show where cuts are? I would love to see that, because I you know, property taxes don't have to go up every year. They can go down. We have the right to do that. Working, you know, doing more with less, it's a challenge that everyone faces. And just because you're a city government doesn't mean that you can't make an attempt at that too. So
I just want to clear one thing up. I didn't agree the fact that we don't compare to other cities. We're like anything else. We're in competition to bring people in, business in, so we are in competition no matter what their populations are or any of that. So that's why we have to be better and streamline and make sure our budgets.
My point simply was is, you know, Wayfair and Oakdale or whatever, but you got a town that's less than 20 miles from here.
Yep.
That is the fastest growing small city in on the east side of the river.
Right.
And none of you mentioned the fact that, geez, you know, we checked out Hugo, and this is what they're doing, and this is how they're getting people.
Well keep you in know, mind, let's when get we were giving this here. Example, the example was that the city chose those, the city manager,
yeah.
That was their choice of cities to compare us to when dealing with the assessments. Now, but why they didn't go to Hugo?
Because that's an easy out for them.
Oh, yeah.
You guys are supposed to be coming up with thinking outside the box, and I'm saying, I'm talking a town that's less than 20 miles from here. Mm-hmm. I would think somebody up there would have maybe looked around and said, who's around 12, 14, 15,000 people, and what are they doing?
That's what I asked Nate last night.
Outside the box.
That's what I asked Nate last night for the city council.
Nate's in the box. Nate's not outside the box. Nate's doing whatever Wally tells him.
The point is, I asked Nate
last night.
I guess I'm not, or Dave, I'm sorry.
You know, to answer that part of it, as a person myself just running for city council, they're not willing to give me the sitting on the information. And your part before, I do have a real job. And my job is the head engineer at Maplewood Middle School. I've been there 10 years. Never, ever been over budget. I don't even come close. My surplus goes back to the general fund. I can't answer for the rest of the school district, but for my building, it's never been over budget, not once. Matter of fact, I am one of the top in the nation. I am a Star Energy building. I cut the cost. One of the reasons I cut the cost, I also pay taxes to the school district. I live here. I don't like to see waste. I won't let my guys just go willy-nilly throwing things around. Use it till it's gone. So that's the kind of person I am. I want to hold our government the same way. Just because there's money there, you better have allegations for that. You better have a purpose. That's the way I look at it. I'm sorry to be so passionate, but that's, you know, but I do have a real job.
That's what's missing. That's my whole point. That's what's missing.
That's why we're here.
Dave wanted to touch on
the budgeting. You know, in 2010, the city cut $400,000, knowing that we were going to have shortfalls. I was in on that one. 2011, they cut $250,000. I lost a couple police officers on it. For 2012, I mean, the 2011, of course, was for the 2012 drop. but I believe the cut is going to be roughly another $250,000 again for 2013. So in fairness, they're working at it. They're trying. They're trying to wean us off of local government aid because it's not going to be dependable. The state promises you the moon, and you're lucky if you get a small meteor. But they are working toward it. I mean, I guess you can accuse me of being an insider, you bet. If you say I didn't have a real job, fine. I served in the military and retired, and I served fire department. I am an insider. Maybe I am in the box. But there's a lot of good things going on here, and sometimes the city gets a bum rap where it shouldn't. A lot of people are working hard to make this city work.
Thanks, Steve.
I absolutely agree with you, but part of my point was if I get on, again, your voice. It's people like you in the business community that need to come to me. I don't have all of them. I did work for a family business, still do on the side. I watched my brother and my grandfather struggle. I see what goes on, and part of the reason that's why I got a government job, I'm like, I would have loved to start a business. And you guys, you're probably working 80, 90 hours a week, you know? And I seen that, and I thought, you know, I got in with the city, I have a great job there. So I see both sides of it. I see what my brother struggles through and trying to keep a budget and trying to keep his equipment operating. It's ridiculous. So I'm all for cutting in more, and I'm all for, like I said, the public coming forward and let me know and getting those ideas out there.
Thanks. Well, it is 25 after 7. The presidential debate is going to be on at 8. I don't know if all of you want to make it there for that, but I feel the passion in the room, so I'm thinking that maybe you want to go home and yell at your TV. But if you have more questions, I'm going to let these guys take a little break, walk around, and you can ask them personally. So we'll just do that till about 8 o'clock.